I would like to thank the organizers, especially Dr. Venkatesh Garu. He was my teacher, and I feel proud to give a lecture on the same dais where I have done my undergraduate from Siddhartha Medical College. My guru in pelvis and acetabulum fractures I have learned from Dr. Hari Sharma sir, and fortunate enough to present a lecture. So Stopa's approach, it was basically designed by a general surgeon, Professor Rene Stopa. He was born in 1921 in French Algeria. To begin with, he was an anatomist, and finally he was a general surgeon, and he has done a lot of gastroenterology work also. Adopted by orthopedic surgeons, so revised for pelvic and acetabular surgery by Hirvan Salo et al. In 1993, and again this was modified by Cole et al. In 1994. So indications, so till now we have seen a lot of fracture patterns, anterior column fractures and pelvic ring injuries. So this provides beautiful access for the pubic body, superior pubic ramus, pubic root, ileum above and below the peritoneal line, quadrilateral plate, medial aspect of the posterior column, sciatic buttress and anterior SI joint. So there are advantages, and one can appreciate the advantage of Stopa's approach only after doing ilioinguinal approach for the anterior pelvic injuries. So it's relatively easy anatomical dissection, unlike the ilioinguinal approach where you have to dissect out a lot of windows, which takes a lot of time for dissection and approaching the fracture. There is better visibility than the ilioinguinal approach, and all anterior elements, especially the quadrilateral plate, can be easily exposed and fixed. There is direct control over the corona mortis, which we are very scared of when doing the ilioinguinal approach. Direct visualization and approach to the posterior column enables fixation of the medial buttress, especially over the quadrilateral plate. So disadvantage. Bearing in mind this disadvantage, approach has been modified, and that is the modified Stopa's approach. And Dr. Krishnakaran will speak on that. This is the disadvantage. Maneuvering the fractures where you have a high anterior column fractures, it's not easy only through the Stopa's approach. You have to modify it. So there are dangers and complications, because basically you will be doing all this dissection between two vascular bundles. Obturator nerve and vessels, they should be retracted carefully to expose the quadrilateral plate. Corona mortis, you will go in only after ligating this corona mortis, either by sutures or clips. External iliac vessels, unlike the ilioinguinal approach where you need to dissect them and retract them, in this Stopa's approach you will elevate them anteriorly and then go behind the anterior iliac vessels. Bladder, so it's always advisable to use a Foley's catheter so that you don't get an inflated bladder. So this is how we go in Stopa's approach. The patient will be in supine position, and roll below the knee on the operation side. It's very important so that you can relax the anterior neurovascular bundle while doing the dissection. The surgeon should be on the opposite side of the fracture. And then incision, this is a fan and steel incision, 2 cm above the pubic symphysis. The skin incision, okay, on the left you have incision where we see the cut skin and the subcutaneous tissue dissected. So this part of the image, I have retracted the rectus sheath, anterior rectus sheath, and you can see the rectus abdominis muscles. And the rectus abdominis muscles in that photograph, you can see they are also dissected in the midline. You cut in the, either you can cut it or just do a finger dissection, the linea alba, and you can separate the rectus abdominis. And you should not detach the complete attachment of the rectus abdominis over the pubic tubercle region. Most of the times when there is pubic diastasis, the pyramidalis muscle and part of the rectus abdominis are already torn from the pubic symphysis. So once you go deep to the rectus abdominis, you see the urinary bladder. And which is the first retractor to be placed once you expose this urinary bladder? So this is the first retractor. You place it posterior to the anterior vascular bundle, neurovascular bundle. And then you appreciate the corona mortis while you are sweeping around the iliopectineal line, then you ligate the corona mortis and then cut the iliopectineal fascia. Thereby you can expose the fracture of the quadrilateral plate or superior pubic ramus. Though it appears scary that you are dissecting between the obturator neurovascular bundle and the anterior external neurovascular, external iliac vessels, this is very easy approach when compared to ilioinguinal. So that is the entire area which you can expose and fix the fractures. So in this picture, you can already see a plate fixed on the pubic ramus. This Deaver's retractor, it is retracting the urinary bladder, and you can see the retractor, something like a cobra, just posterior to the anterior external iliac, external neurovascular bundle, and you can see the plate and screws. So that is how you can place your plate and screws in this approach. So once you fix the fracture, you again close back the linea alba, And since we do a finger dissection, it's very easy and to close this. In iliointerval, you need to spend a lot of time again closing all the three windows. Even the risk of hernia is also very little in this Topaz approach. One example, so here there is pubic symphysis diastasis and fracture of the quadrilateral plate. Only through Topaz approach you can achieve such a fixation. Because though you feel the fracture in iliointerval, you can't instrument it. So it's very difficult to pass all the drill bits and do that. This is one more case. The quadrilateral plate can be fixed like this in this fashion only through the Topaz approach. So thank you for a patient hearing.